Most people in the ABA community know that there are four functions of behavior. However, we usually only hear and talk about three of them. The fourth function that usually isn't discussed is behaviors related to pain or stress, which in technical terms is called automatic negative reinforcement. Hi, I'm Dr. Mary Barbera, autism mom, board-certified behavior analyst, online course creator, and best-selling author of The Verbal Behavior Approach. Each week, I provide you with some of my ideas about turning autism around. So if you haven't subscribed to my YouTube channel, you can do that now. Today, I'm sharing a small excerpt from a recent podcast episode I did where I break down the four functions of behavior in an easy-to-understand format and discuss in detail the all-important forgotten function. So we have four functions of behavior. And one function is the child cries or hits or cry, you know, hits, bites, kicks, screams. So let's just say child bites his hand. The first function is what we call socially mediated positive reinforcement, which means in the past when he's bit his hand, it has meant that something good happens. He has received positive reinforcement that has followed biting his hand. So this might be the child bites his hands because he wants something, and in the past he's gotten it. So this could be child wants candy in the candy aisle at the grocery store. Okay, so that's the first function. Socially mediated positive reinforcement. Socially mediated means people are involved, and positive means he receives the candy. He's given the candy. Then we have socially mediated negative reinforcement. Let's take, still, we're talking about the same child, Johnny. He bites his hand when he doesn't want to do something, to get out of something. So it's time to take a bath. Bites his hand, and then mom says, well, you know what? He got a bath last night. He's not that dirty. Let's not do it. Now Johnny has learned, okay, so I bite my hand to get things. I bite my hand to get out of things. That's socially mediated negative reinforcement. So both of those functions, people are involved. We tend to see those functions a lot in the classroom setting and home settings. And this isn't just for children with autism. This is children, adults. These are functions that have been proven as to why behaviors occur. Okay, so we have the two socially mediated functions, and then we have two additional functions that are called automatic, which means people don't have to be involved. The adults don't have to be in the picture. They can be included in the environment, but it's not that they are adding or taking away. So we have the automatic positive reinforcement. So it tends to feel good or sound good to the student or the child. And Johnny may bite his hand just to stimulate himself. I know that sounds weird because you would think that that would cause pain. But, you know, even let's just say he's not really biting on his hands. He's biting the cuticles of his fingers, and he's biting them kind of raw. He's doing that because he likes the way it feels, potentially. Let's use another example, like self-stimulatory behavior, where the child might be rocking, might be verbal stimming, like la 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 la, wah wah wah, making noises. Because either way, this positive reinforcement, this stimming or this biting on the cuticles, or there's rocking, some head banging may occur, is because the child doesn't have the language, doesn't have the play skills and other skills that are needed to occupy his mind. Okay, so that's automatic positive reinforcement. And then we have the automatic negative reinforcement, which is pain attenuation. So a child might bite his hand if he's in pain or stress. And this is what happened to Lucas. When he was 13 or 14 years old, he started to bite his hand. And he also, at that point, was able to tell us he had a headache. And so he's biting his hand and he was saying, "Head hurts." And it was like stabbing pain that I think the biting actually drew his attention to the pain in his hand, and then the headache miraculously went away even before I could run downstairs to get Motrin. So it seems like it, why would that be? So the thing I learned in early August, I went to the National Autism Conference at Penn State University, and I've been there many times. It's a great conference. It's always in early August, and it's always great. And they do live streaming, and some of the 3-hour lectures are recorded. And I saw Dr. Tim Vollmer there, who's an expert in these 4 functions of behavior. He was talking a decent amount about automatic positive and negative reinforcement. And so I am going to link that in the show notes so that you can watch the lecture by Dr. Tim Vollmer if you are interested. I think it's a fascinating lecture. And I asked him the question, I was interested in studies on automatic negative reinforcement, the pain attenuation, because I have a strong interest in this. I know that over time, it's been proven that Lucas's self-injurious behavior and aggression was related to pain and distress. And so when I asked Dr. Tim Vollmer about the studies on automatic negative reinforcement, he said right away, that there are 0 studies on automatic negative reinforcement. And that he also added later in the lecture that all animals like monkeys and birds and rats, they bite on things when they're in distress, when they're in pain or stressed. And so he hypothesizes that some of the biting behavior, biting on your hand or biting others, could definitely indicate that the child is in some kind of distress and possibly pain. He also added that in the past, before anesthesia, that humans were taught or given a towel to bite on. My dad said, like in the cowboy movies, that to get a bullet out, they were, they'd often show a towel and a person biting on a towel. So just after seeing Dr. Vollmer and him talking about biting and other species and that, I just was more interested in doing this episode for this podcast. And I'm also trying to tell behavior analysts, like, we can't just use bite guards and use helmets. If the kids are having self-injurious behavior, we really need to get to the bottom of this. And we are, by our ethical code, behavior analysts need to have these medical conditions ruled out before we go treating problem behaviors with keeping the demand on procedure, which I don't recommend hardly at all, and all kinds of behavioral procedures. We need to figure out what's going on medically. And it's really impossible when children are either not speaking at all or have limited language. I hope you enjoyed this short snippet from the podcast. If you want more content, check out the podcast at marybarbera.com/podcast. Wherever you're watching this, I'd love it if you would leave me a comment, give me a thumbs up, share this video with others who may benefit. And for more information, you can attend a free online workshop at marybarbera.com/workshop. And I'll see you right here next week.